Think we'll go ahead and kick this off. Liz and Harry, you feel good about starting?
Yeah.
Thumbs up. Okay. Well, welcome everybody to VMFA Fridays After Five, A Taste of Art, French Wines, presented by Chase. And thank you to our sponsor, Chase, for making this possible. My name is Celeste Feta. I'm Director of Education here at the museum, and I'm joined by two special guests tonight, Harry Tation from Free Run Wine Merchants and Liz Skirpin, a manager at Amuse at VMFA. We're going to be diving into two wines today from the Gamay grape. So before we get started, just a little bit of housekeeping and some logistics to go over. Just some tips. Some of you may have joined us last time, and thank you for joining us then, and welcome back. If you're new to Taste of Art, here's how we do it. So if you bought the wine, thank you. And pairing that wine tonight, go ahead and open those bottles now so you're not wasting any time as we move through this presentation. This is a webinar format, which means you can see us, but we cannot see you. Use that to your advantage if you'd like. It also means that the best way to communicate with us is to use the chat feature. So that should be located at the bottom of your screen on that kind of bar that pops up in your webinar screen. And you can hit that chat button. Oh, someone already did. Hi. Hi, Chow. And just say hi to us if you'd like, share your impressions. That's also going to be where, if you have a question for any of us, go ahead and put that in the chat button. Liz is going to help us monitor that. I'll be looking at it. Harry will be looking at it. So all of us may pop in and out with questions that we see from you or observations that we want to share from you. We will be asking for, if you are tasting, your impressions of the wine, and of course, impression of the art. So please, if you're comfortable using that chat button, go ahead and do that because that makes it engaging. The format of this, like I said, if you've been here before or new to us, is very casual. This is a conversation. We're going to chat about where the wine is from, a little bit about the art, and we just want to have a good time talking. So that's the plan for tonight. So I am going to advance the slide, and we'll get started with our first selection. So I'm going to kick it over to Harry. And Harry, again, for people who are new or haven't met you before, just a little bit about what you do, and then we can get started.
Sure. Thanks. Thank all of y'all for coming in for another week. We had a really good one of these a few weeks ago that I thought was very successful and a lot of fun. Good questions. So my name is Harry Tation. I'm with Free Run Wine Merchants. We're a locally owned distributor and importer of wines. We sell wines to independent restaurants and wine shops in Maryland, Virginia, and DC. I've known Celeste and Liz for years now, and so we thought this would be a great thing to do to get together and just introduce some of our wines in the regions. And I love the tie into the arts that Celeste has found to highlight with the wines. So thank you all for coming. So the first one, we're gonna do two wines today, both from France. One is gonna be from the Loire Valley and one is gonna be from the Beaujolais region of Burgundy. If you can see on that map on the left there, the Loire Valley starts all the way up on the northwest coast of France near Nantes, right on the Atlantic Ocean. And that's where you see wines like Muscadet and further inland and Sancerre. But if you follow the cursor from that top left area of Nantes, the Loire Valley goes all the way over to the right and then all the way down to the south. The first one we're going to start with, though, is from the Beaujolais region, Burgundy there to the right, and that southern part near the south, almost directly to the east of where the other wine we're having from tonight comes from, which I thought that would be interesting. Two Gamay grapes from two different regions within France. So, the first wine, you want to go and talk about the first wine, Celeste?
Yes.
Okay, so Gamay, there's a picture of the Gamay grapes. They're a large grape, tight clusters. It's usually one of the first grapes that's harvested every year. Harvest usually starts in August into September, and some of the wines, like the second wine we're going to have tonight, is actually later in the season, in October, that's harvested. But Gamay is one of the lighter red grapes. It's a great wine for fall. They're usually very light, not real mouth-filling. And when I say mouth-filling, think of like water and milk. water being very light in your mouth, milk being kind of heavier in your mouth, Gamay is going to lean to that lighter side, very fresh and light in your mouth, which works really well with foods. And I know that Liz is going to talk in a little while about some of the foods that works with these, which I think sound great. So Gamay is going to be the name of the grape. The first one we're going to do is the Hirsch Beaujolais Village. It is a Gamay Beaujolais grape from the southern part of Burgundy. It's a 2019 vintage. One thing I'll note about the bottle is that it is in what they call a Bordeaux-shaped bottle. And a Bordeaux-shaped bottle is that tall, narrow bottle like you might know. And then the other one is going to be in a Burgundy-shaped bottle that you'll see. So different shape bottles.
Hey, Harry, we have a question.
Yes.
Already. Yeah, Birch Douglas would like to know, how long before drinking should a Beaujolais Village be opened and allowed to breathe in the bottle?
I feel pretty sure that you can open a Beaujolais and leaving it in the bottle, you can open it right away and drink it immediately, or it really would not hurt to sit in the bottle for a little while. If you have a decanter, or just pour it in your glass. Pour it in your glass and swirl it around a little bit, and that will kind of aerate it and get it more to maybe the point that you're thinking is the style and flavor that you want. I say many times that wine is such a subjective beverage. Some people might want it to be a certain way. Some people might want it to be a different way. And those, both of those ways are right. I think it's the thing to remember about wine. So I say that a lot. So this is a young couple. There you are, Celine and Nicolas Hirsch. They are originally from the Alsace region of France, which is up in the northeast part of France, just kind of due east of Paris and near Champagne. Alsace is one of those regions in France that has been under French rule and German rule back and forth over the years. Right now it is French rule. The couple here, they moved to Beaujolais in 2011. Before that, they had worked around France, California, and New Zealand making wines. Beaujolais as a region is divided into 9 different crews or kind of neighborhoods, if you think of it that way. And this couple, Celine and Nicolas, they have vineyards in Chinas, Julianas, and Moulin-Avant. Those are 3 really well-respected crews within the Beaujolais region. They have 5.5 hectares, which is about 14 acres of fruit. It's all estate fruit. Estate fruit meaning they grow and have control over everything that they grow. There's nobody telling them when to do this and when to do that. So they have complete control, which I think is an ideal situation for a winemaker. Beautiful landscapes, you can see. Elevation in the Beaujolais region is not crazy high. They're about 1,200 feet, maybe, elevation, so not crazy. And I think that works really well for the grape they use, the Beaujolais Gamay grape. So the wine, should we go into taste now, or do you want to talk about the art of some of these wines?
Let's taste.
Yeah, I think taste is good. And Harry, we had a question. Yeah. Your audio seems a little low.
Sure. Let's see if this will do. Test, is that any better? A little bit louder? Maybe not?
Seems a little louder.
I'll try and talk a little bit louder too.
Yeah, thank you.
For sure. So that's some pictures of the vineyards of Hirsch Vineyards. So one of the reasons we chose this, because both of these guys are organic. So they have all kinds of flowers and grasses they grow in between the vines, and they till them back into the soil. They don't use herbicides or pesticides, which I think comes across in the wine. Very clean, very natural style of making wine. But look at the size of those roots of those vines. Those are old vine Gamay grapes, which I think is pretty amazing. Like I said, Beaujolais is such a light, easy drinking wine, especially the Village we're going to taste. I know you were saying you have an idea of how many people have the wines to taste. If you don't have these wines to taste, but you have another Beaujolais you're tasting, or just another wine to enjoy while we're talking, I think is fine and fun. I'll try to tell you a little bit about these wines and what these flavors are like. I don't always like to say about the flavors you're tasting, because I say always that one person might taste one flavor and another person might taste another flavor, and they're both right. We're all rather physiologically different, and we perceive flavors differently. So I don't feel like there's a lot of wrong answers in what you're perceiving in wine. I think there's a important thing to remember that if you don't taste a flavor that I might mention, or Celeste or Liz mention, that doesn't matter. I think that that's what you're tasting is what you taste. So remember that when you're trying these wines. Next photo, is that another?
So I think it's a food pairing. So I don't you know, if like if you have the wine with you, want to give it a swirl, and
let's go ahead and
I
take
do not, so I'm going to rely on Liz and Harry to live vicariously through you.
The Hirsch Village, and they call it a village again because they're using grapes from different neighborhoods or crews within the Beaujolais region. So this is all Beaujolais. They grow in their vineyards. This is all done in a stainless steel. There's no oak on this. Most Beaujolais you don't see in oak barrels. Usually they come in stainless steel. So they're very clean. The fruit comes through. It's very bright. And I think that's what you want on wines like this. This is a village blend of their three different crews. So Beaujolais, as you can see from the color, if you can tell, usually tends to be very light, not very dark. You'll see when we get to the next wine, which is also Gamay, but it's a little bit darker hue, I think. But you're gonna have kind of light berry flavors. You have good tannic acids in them. Another thing to think about is, since we're thinking about Beaujolais and we're thinking about November, every November there's a very large thing that happens in the wine world called Beaujolais Nouveau. It's released in the third week of November every year. And that's kind of it is true Beaujolais, but I do think that what we're doing here, the Beaujolais Village and the Côte Rouennaise wines are very different animals than the Beaujolais Nouveau. Beaujolais Nouveaus are meant to be lighter, fruitier, very easy to consume. I think all Beaujolais are kind of easy to consume, but I think that the Beaujolais Nouveau is really meant to be enjoyed early and just a non-complex, easy quaffing type of red, patio red, you might call it.
We have a question from Sue Mellon. She would like to know if there's any significance with the wax topping on top of the cork.
Good question. Honestly, no. Really more aesthetics. I think they just like the idea of it. I mean, sometimes when you have a cork there, the cap's sort of shattered. Yes, that happens lots of times when you have those red plastic corks. You know, I usually run the worm right through the middle of the cork and just try to pull it up. And usually you end up with a little bit kind of left on the edge of the rim of the bottle. But it usually comes out fairly clean. Usually the wax, where am I? There you go. The wax stays on top of the cork like that. But I know that in a restaurant situation, it's kind of awkward when a server's at the table and you're trying to open up a wax capped bottle like that, and the wax pieces will fall over the table and everything. So please hold that against your server. This is,
happens hard to pour.
Yeah, this happens. It's like on the floor. Somebody will get it later, I guess. But it is, and sometimes wax caps can be almost what I call like a vulcanized wax, which is almost kind of rubbery, and they don't really crack as much. But I do like it just for an aesthetic look. It's just kind of a nice closure, a nice finish. There's no foil around this. It was just the red cap, the red wax on top. Cap shattered, yes. So aesthetics and I think, yeah, just for the way it looks, Birch is the answer on that one. So Liz, you've poured yourself a little bit.
Yes, I have.
But also, you know, just kind of basic wine things. When you see wine, people swirl glasses like that. Really what they're doing is they're getting the aromas up into the bowl of the glass. So that when you put your nose in the glass and you smell, you're going to smell a more concentrated aroma than if you don't swirl it and just have it as is.
And a Gamay is a good grape to bring out those bigger wine glasses for, isn't it?
It is. You get to swirl a little bit more. And, you know, that really does bring so many. You see lots of wine bowls that are very shaped. You know, very, very close at the neck. And I think it really is also just to get the aromas in the glass and get the aromas. There's a ratio I've always heard that 80% of flavors come from aroma. So that's when you have a cold, things just don't taste right. If you hold your nose while you're eating, things just don't taste right. You don't perceive flavors. So I think that when you smell a wine like this, you can really get a whole lot more of what the flavors are. And you see wine people sometimes, and we might have talked about this last time, where they aerate it in their mouth. They'll do that kind of sucking in kind of thing. And you choke a little bit sometimes. But I think that what that does, it really gets the flavors into your into your nasal passages, into your throat, and you can definitely get more flavors. more flavors out of that.
Yeah, and for a wine like a grape like Gamay, that's a little bit more subtle, especially like a lighter one this way, it's kind of nice to pull that all in and to give it more room in your mouth and in your glass.
And I think when we move to the Gamay grape from the Côte Rouennaise area, we're going to see it's more aromatic, more explosive in the glass, and, you know, just more intense aromas. Mm-hmm. But I think for this, it's very light, easy drinking, good aromas. The mouthfeel and the texture is very light and clean and crisp. I think you get a little bit of an earthiness to it, but I think that works well, and it works really well with foods.
So we were thinking Thanksgiving, which is kind of what I always think about when I think about Beaujolais and Gamay. It's very good pairings for that. This is a little precursor to our Amuse Thanksgiving that we're getting ready to do next month. And we were taking some photos, and a lot of the food that we'll be serving is a great pairing to go with this. And the thing about Gamay is that it's really versatile. It's kind of a food lover's wine as well. It goes very well with everything, well, with a lot of things, including this, which is baked oysters. And they're baked oysters that have a black garlic sauce underneath the shell. So that black garlic and the kind of saltiness of the oysters does go really well with Gamay and with this Beaujolais. It's also nice to know if you're ever ordering for a large table of people and people have tons of different types of food. I think Gamay is a good selection for that as well, because you can have it with seafood and you can have it with meats and light meats and dark meats, because it does have a good acid to it. So it will go through kind of the creaminess you can see on the top of those oysters, but it's still light enough that you'll be able to taste the seafood quality of the oyster as well.
Yeah, I have like the art as a question. So we're gonna continue to enjoy this Gamay. So as you're drinking that and kind of tasting those flavors, and thank you, Harry and Liz, that was awesome information to know about. And I can't have seafood, but if I did, I could. I would have that. That looks amazing with a Gamay. So when we're thinking about kind of the regions of France and also about these tastings, I wanted to pick some art that was kind of resonated with the landscape and with the areas that we're talking about. So we're looking at Burgundy as a region, and Beaujolais is part of that Burgundy region. And that's an area really famous for the Burgundian territories and medieval art. So just to give you some context, again, with a map, because we love our maps. So on the left is a map of 15th century France and the Kingdom of France and the Burgundy regions that were controlled by the Dukes of Burgundy. So you see Dijon there, right here, right around the same region that we're tasting the wine, the Gamay wine right now from. And that region extended all the way up into Belgium and the Netherlands. And these two guys here are pretty, really made that happen. So on the left, we have Philip the Bold and then his son, John the Fearless. And I just love these images because they're just, I don't know, maybe they're living up to their names there, maybe. I don't know about Fearless, but, you know, I didn't know him. So one of the really tour de force work of arts that come out of this region in the 15th century are the tombs of those two gentlemen that I just showed you. So here we have the tomb of Philip the Bold on the left, and a detail of the underside of the tomb there you see, known as the mourners. His son also did a similar tomb, you know, because he was so impressed with what his father's was, and so commissioned the same studio to do that, Klaus Sutter Studio. And these are really amazing small sculptures, very small. They're in size, I would say, ranging from 11 inches to 16 inches high, so not very tall at all. And you can see that they're sort of almost looks like they're moving through these Gothic cloisters. And this time period, the Middle Ages around this time is also known as Gothic. And you can tell that sort of architecture in the cloisters here, that they're walking under these pointed arches and highly decorative spaces. This is at the Musée des Beaux-Arts in Dijon. So they were in a separate tomb and cathedral that was damaged and then moved in the 19th century to Dijon. And of the VMFA members or people who come to the museum often, we had an exhibition of the mourners from John the Fearless's tomb back in 2011-12, because the Dijon Museum was going through a renovation. So they went on this sort of international tour, and we were the last stop of the tour. And this is an installation shot from that exhibition. And really for the first time, the mourners came out of the cloisters. So you could really see them in detail. And again, these are small works of art, but they're very expressive and very naturalistic. This was a big shift from before Gothic and the kind of the Romanesque era where everyone was very stiff. and kind of flat against a column, not very expressive. And we're moving into the Gothic period, into this Renaissance where the human body is being explored a little bit more, and people wanted to see things in a more naturalistic way. Also, the purpose of these, again, is on a tomb. So these are replicating these emotions of mourning and sadness among all the sort of cast that we're living. So we have clergymen, we have nobility, and we have commoners. So you see a friar here on the left, someone completely cloaked in sadness and darkness on the right. So we can't tell like what station this person is in. And I think that goes back to that emotion, you know, of grief is a universal emotion. It doesn't matter, you know, where you're coming from or what your job is, that grief is something that is an emotion that connects us all.
Celestia, back to the other ones. I remember we did an Art of Wine thing back a few years ago, and we did it when you had statues called the Avignons here. Is that what these are? They look like them a little bit.
Maybe, because these would be coming from Dijon.
Okay.
To think about that. I'll look back and see.
Avignons.
Go ahead, Harry.
No, so the Avignons were, they were that exhibit you did, I guess, and we did Burgundy wines, I think, when we did it.
Oh, maybe so.
Again, this was probably 6, 7.
Yeah. Maybe so. Gosh, you got a good memory.
I thought it was cool because I thought the little Avignon statues were amazing, and you had a lot of them, so it was very cool.
Yeah, probably, yeah. In our own collection, we have an example, again, talk about expression. So very expressive sculpture here, our Saint Denis, also from the early 15th century. So around the same time period, this is larger, it's about 4 feet tall, and on view in our medieval galleries. Saint Denis, so the legend is that he was a bishop, he was martyred on Montmartre, so the Montmartre in Paris, so that becomes very famous, of course, later, when we're talking about Impressionist artists at the turn of the century. So legend is he was beheaded there, and he carried his own head and walked to where now the church or the Abbey of St. Denis stands, where he collapsed and then was buried. So that is what this statue is depicting here, that moment after beheading where he picks up his head. So again, very expressive, a little gory, you know, but it's about that emotion and that sense of devotion where he becomes, right, otherworldly or saintly. In action. This is a pretty common depiction of Saint Denis, so you'll see this depiction in art and in sculpture. It would have been, you see traces of polychromy here, so imagine this brightly painted. So it's, again, telling a story. It would have been situated in a church, probably against a column. It is not in the round, so it has a flat back. That's how we can tell where that would have been positioned. And just to give you a sense of kind of where St. Denis as the Abbey is, this is one of the first really Gothic churches. So remember I said before, this kind of pointed arches that we saw in Philip the Bold's tomb, a lot of telltale signs it's Gothic, kind of that rose window, stained glass window, almost looks like lace. And some flying buttresses here. And that's that architectural innovation that allows light to come in instead of building a straight wall. So all the support is on the outside. I kind of akin it to like if you're pulling back a curtain and, you know, the curtains are being held up, you know, with your curtain holders. So it lets that light in instead of just straight down. That's kind of a way to think about it.
Do you want to take a few questions?
Sure.
Yeah. So going back to the portraits that we did a few slides ago.
Sure.
There's a question about why are the portraits in profile?
Oh, here?
I think.
Go back. Oh, these guys? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a great question. You know, I think it probably might have been a little bit easier to do so. You know, I don't know. Maybe one side looked better than the other.
I like that answer.
Pretty typical too, I would say. I know there must be something about looking left instead of right, so I'll have to work on that and get back to you on that one. Any other questions in this area? And just real quickly, we'll, because I know we want to get to the next one, to a next set of works of art. I threw this one in here, and I apologize for the image. I took this with my cell phone because the images that we have in terms of digital aren't great and have some watermarks on them. So do forgive me. So come see this in person if you can. This is our Falconer. Again, same time period. So not a religious subject, but a secular subject. And I say French or German because there's a little bit of conflicting ideas on where this came from. And I think that gets back to, you know, our winemakers coming from Alsace and moving down to South. Same kind of thing, you know, things were kind of moving back and forth on who was controlling what during when. So I thought it was a nice contrast and not, you know, emotional to look at. So it depicts a falconer, kind of age old sport. And I pair it with an image of a contemporary falconer in France. So this is coming back as a sport. And actually, at a lot of wineries, particularly in California and in France, falconry is being used as a form of pest control for the wineries. So all comes back to wine, you know. You can make anything connect. By the way, this is like my worst nightmare. I can't think of anything like more frightening than a bird of prey. I'm just going to say that out there. So I overcame my fear just for you all to share that image. All right. Are there any other questions kind of about that area or anything that we're missing? No, thanks, Liz, before we move on. Okay. All right. So let's, what did everyone think about the wine they just tasted? If you're tasting that, if you want to share in the chat. Any impressions as we kind of kick over to our next selection, Harry?
Okay, so the first one we had was in that kind of salmon-colored area, the southern part of Beaujolais. That is where Celine and Nicolas Hirsch are located. And if you go directly to the left, there is a little town called Roannais. Roanne. The appellation is Roannais. But I think the thing that's just so amazing about this is that the Loire Valley comes all the way across, you know, more than halfway across France, and then just due south of Paris, it turns south all the way down to...
Let me help you here. Hold on. I got my cursor.
So yeah, Paris, and it comes all the way down to the south. The thing that's interesting about this is the soil in both of these areas are just... east and west of each other are both very similar. They have a very granite-based soil there. Gamay tends to do very well it. I think you get a minerality on these Beaujolais wines, on both of them. I think it comes from this this granite soil. The next producer we're going to talk about is named Robert Serol. They're a family-owned producer. They have 35 hectares of land, which is about 80 acres total, all estate fruit. Stefan, the son, took over from his father in about 1996. Since then, he's had all his vineyards converted to biodynamic. Biodynamic is a form of agriculture that was developed by an Austrian agronomist named Rudolf Stein, probably, I'm thinking, in the 1800s. Not positive of that, though. But his whole idea of agriculture, and it wasn't just for grapes, it was for all types of agricultural products, was to plant, harvest, fertilize, do everything in conjunction with the phases of the moon, the levels of the sea, all types of natural phenomena that directed what he did in the vineyards. And a lot of wineries have adopted that to be a more natural way of making wines. And that is what Stefan did with his property when he took over from his dad. So all of his properties and vineyards are now certified biodynamic. He uses a Gamay clone called Saint Romain, which is an old variety. It's harvested later in the season than the grapes that the Hirsches grow. Their grapes are harvested probably in August, September, maybe September. But the Serol grapes, they don't harvest until mid-October. So I think you get longer hang time on the vine, more concentration of fruit in the grapes. And I think that if we pour the wine, you can see there's definitely a darker version of Gamay in a clear glass side by side. It'd be nice to see the differences, because I think the Saint Romain variety is definitely darker, richer, heartier style, a little bit harder tannins, but that actually makes it a better food wine. I know that Liz was talking about Thanksgiving a little while ago. Thanksgiving is one of the hardest meals to pick a wine for, because you have so many flavors, sweet flavors, savory flavors, all kinds of things. So Beaujolais is a perfect wine to go with Thanksgiving. This being a little bit darker versus the one we had first. Another thing that they do with their wines at Serolles is they age and ferment them in cement tanks. Cement tanks was an ancient way of making wine that people used before stainless steel became in vogue. A lot of European producers have room-sized tanks that are cement, but they have an enamel glaze lining on the inside. And for some reason, wine likes that as a medium to age and rest in, and these guys have done that. Along those lines, if you go visit any wineries now in Virginia, Oregon, Washington, California, Europe, you're gonna see these concrete eggs. They've become very popular in wineries. They probably hold, I guess, about 1,000 gallons maybe. They're, you know, probably about 8, 9, 10 feet tall. Can't get your arms around them, but they also have that enamel glaze on the inside. And the physics of winemaking, I don't know, but it seems like the curvature of that egg is something that wines like. The way that everything's happening inside the egg, wines seem to like. So if you can pour yourself some of the Saint Romain Gamay from Serolles and give that a taste, you won't get any of the oakiness because there's no oak on it. That cement that I talk about, that gives no minerality or cement note to the wine, because that enamel glaze they line the inside of those tanks with. Just a very clean, pure way of making wines. So let's give it a taste if people have a chance. And again, if you have something else to try, feel free and give that a taste too.
And on the questions, Birch Douglas says we're talking about the last wine, that it has nice light tannins, and I totally agree with that. And Sue says that she liked it better once it opened up. She opened it yesterday and she preferred it today. And Sue, I had the exact same experience. I opened it yesterday and it was good. And then today I liked it much better, so.
You know, it's funny. I like to equate or relate wines to bananas and apples. Once you peel a banana or you start eating into an apple, the oxygen starts to make the fruit deteriorate. And that's the same thing that happens with wine. Once you pull the cork on it, the wine starts to break down a little bit, but lots of times that breakdown is better the next day. Because when you open it the first day, sometimes it's not quite as approachable as you want it to be. But once you've had oxygen to it for a day or so, I know when I sample wines, I don't always sample wines from the same bottle the second day, but sometimes I do, if it's going to show better. And then of course I'll tell the customer, this was open yesterday and I think it's showing better today, like you just did with this. So no, that's a great point.
I just think this is so interesting that it's the same grape grown very close to the first wine that we had, and it's so different than the other
same
wine.
Same type of soil, same type of everything. Although that it's nearby each other, Hirsch, I think they harvest their grapes earlier in the season, and the Serolles family, they do wait into mid-October. So you do get a little bit more hang time on the vine, concentration in the grapes, kind of a darker note to the wines, I believe. Everything's done by hand, hand harvested. I think I read that they bring in like 15 people total during harvest is about it. They're a pretty small operation. So I wish, you know, the thing about this is you can't really hear what people think about the wine. So if you guys want to type any notes, I like the nice tannins, Birch, you said. I agree. These are light tannins, and that makes it a good food wine. It makes it a good sipping wine. I know our company, Free Run, we tend to represent producers that have a light hand in winemaking, a more minimal intervention style, which you get 10 more higher acids, tannic wines, which are better for foods. If you have those kind of lush, gobby, fruit bomb wines, nothing wrong with them, and they're great to enjoy and experience, but they're not always the best match for food.
And this is usually the kind of wine I would buy in the restaurant, or that's something I look at when I'm buying wine for the restaurant. As soon as I taste it, I kind of immediately go to what type of food I want right now. And whenever I make that connection immediately like that, that's when I know it's going to appeal well to a customer, because we're a restaurant and you're going to want to eat. And again, we went to Thanksgiving. I had turkey last night for dinner, and this goes very well with turkey. And I think that it will go really well with with gamey meats, duck, even roast chicken with some good fat on it with the crispy skin would be very good. But if you had like salmon or some type of fish with a higher fatty content, a fatty oil, it would be really good with that as well. And cheese. I think this is would be pretty good with a lot of cheeses.
Yeah, I know. I like saying salmon and tuna are a fish that people don't always think about. You know, I think a general rule is fish is white wine and red meats are red wines. But a salmon or tuna, which is that oily, a little bit more oily and usually cut into a steak style of cut, works really well with the acidity and kind of the light flavors you have from Gamay. They complement each other. They don't overpower. So, you know, the whole thing with wine pairings, you want them to complement each other.
Yeah.
You know, you want the wine to make the food taste better and the food to make the wine taste better, which is hard to, you know, sometimes it's hard to do. And but when you get it right, it's like, wow, that's such a great match.
And Sue, yeah, again, she opened it yesterday and it was more easy drinking yesterday. And today it's much more of a food wine. It does, I think the opening it up did bring out some complexities maybe that weren't, when it got let the oxygen get to it, that wasn't necessarily as apparent yesterday. I agree with that too. And cheese,
I think the idea of cheese, Sue and Liz, what you're saying, I think I would maybe look at maybe a harder cheese. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'd go with like a big creamy, like a brie or a you know, and Andre and things like that. I think I would look for more of a harder cheese. I think it would complement these flavors.
I think so too.
So let's see. You know, both of these couples that are making wine, they're both very young. I think they're both probably in their 30s, maybe 40. So they've got years and years to go. Lots of wineries like the Searle family, he took over from his father. Whereas the Hirsches started their own thing after traveling around, coming from Alsace into Beaujolais. So they would have their own ways of making wines and in their direction. And I say it lots of times, winemakers are artists. You know, they take the medium that they have, be it grapes, and those grapes have been affected by the soil and the weather, the terroir, they call it. And then they put their blend together that they want to put their name on, that they want to endorse. Which I think kind of goes in hand in hand with art pieces.
Great segue, Harry.
Yes.
Thanks for setting me up.
Yes, there you go.
yeah, definitely the same. So kind of artist experience, but also kind of their life experience, but also who they may be working with or for, you know, really has an influence on what they produce. And I would say the same for architecture, you know, form follows function. So we're going to dive a little bit into some more architecture. I know I gave you a taste of some Gothic, and we're going to keep going with that theme, but do a little bit of Renaissance too. And I say Renaissance because that's a big kind of recognizable feature in terms of architecture of the Loire Valley. So we're just gonna keep on that theme with Loire and come back up that river. So we were down south, we're gonna travel back up kind of closer to Paris and kind of hit this arc of the Loire Valley. And I've got an arrow pointing to Amboise. So we're gonna explore Chateau d'Amboise a little bit. And here it is there. Wouldn't you love to go there right now? It looks so peaceful. Oof. And if anyone has been to the Loire Valley, you know, or has seen this, you know, feel free to pipe in. I have not been there, so I can't give you any personal experience there, but please share. And before I do, actually, there was a question about the pick of the food pairing in the last image. Liz?
Yeah, I was doing, it's kind of our pot pie that we're doing for Thanksgiving that has a lot of deep roasted vegetables with herbs and kind of a like a thick earthy gravy to it. So we thought that would be a good pairing for this for the Thanksgiving.
Was that a puff pastry?
Yeah, they do it in puff pastry. So he'll make a puff pastry and then I'll put the vegetables and the meat and everything in top and then kind of, it's an elegant pot pie.
Hey Russ, can you pull that back?
Yeah.
Food pick, there you go, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, perfect.
Let's see. Jane, we did a barge trip on Loire, visiting vineyards and markets and a balloon ride over Chateau. Visited Loire several times, including Amboise. Okay, great. Sounds like an awesome trip.
Yes.
So please, share, or if I, you know, miss quote or say something, please jump in. This is definitely, I'd be really interested to hear your feedback.
The Loire Valley, and I think you have it here on this note here from Angers on the far left, all the way over to Orleans and Sur-Loire. There are all these chateaus along the way that are just showstoppers. Like I said, people like Jane, you know, they go and you visit these chateaus, and it's just, you know, it's mind-boggling that one. Anytime you go to Europe, I think, you know, the time frame of everything just blows most people away. The things were that long ago, since a lot of our homes were built in 1900 or newer.
It's also known as kind of the Valley of the Kings, you know, for France. A lot of these chateaus obviously were built by people who had the means to do so. And that's certainly the case for Chateau Amboise, again, pictured here. So the buildings and construction range from the 15th century to the 19th century. Lots of things happened here. So you actually enter the chateau from this side, so not on the river side. And those turrets that you see are towers, very typical of French Renaissance architecture and very quintessential kind of chateau that you would be used to seeing. The work of art from our collection actually depicts that entryway. So on the left is a drawing by Thomas Lafarge, View of Chateau of Amboise. And this is really the spot he probably was sitting, just kind of down here and maybe skewed to the left a little bit, of this small chapel. And again, that Renaissance tower with that really steep sloped roof, which was really cool to kind of piece those two together. Thomas Lafarge has a fascinating kind of life story. And we're hearing from a lot of people who note that Leonardo da Vinci is buried there. We'll show you that tomb. So this is the inside of the chapel at St. Hubert, where da Vinci is entombed. And he was actually invited to Chateau Amboise by Francis I, invited him to come and work there. So he did make art there and advise on architecture. And he lived there from 1516 to 1519 when he died, and was buried at another location, and then moved to the St. Hubert Chapel, which is a Gothic building. We see those soaring arches on the inside and stained glass window, lots of like lacy detail. So that theme definitely continues. And Thomas Lafarge, he was born into a family of artists. His grandfather was John Lafarge, who was a contemporary to Tiffany, and actually would say a rival in stained glass to Tiffany. And his father was an artist. Thomas's middle name was Sargent. So again, kind of this nod back to really an artist's life and a love of art. His father moved to France from Connecticut, moved to Paris. And so Thomas was actually born there. He had three siblings, and they lived there for 12 years and then came back to the States, and he went to Yale and Harvard. This drawing from the collection was done in 1926. So probably after he had graduated. So guessing he probably went back to France. And might have been drawn to Amboise because da Vinci's tomb was there. So he did a lot of interior design and mosaics, as well as murals. So he worked with his father, who was a muralist as well. And this is from an exhibition at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art, that they had in the 30s, where they mounted or kind of invited artists to propose mural designs. So this is Thomas Lafarge's mural design that he proposed and exhibited in this exhibition. He actually had gone to Mexico in 1931 and met Diego Rivera, very influenced by Rivera. This is very different than the drawing that we saw, you know, which is very probably done on the spot. It was done in a black kind of Conte crown, so very fast. This is definitely plotted out and very mechanic, and got great reviews. So I thought I'd just read kind of what the reviewers said about this work when it was on view. Lafarge's contribution to the present exhibition is seriously imaginative. It relates invention and science to creative power, human and superhuman. It uses swirls, diagonals, and airplane viewpoints so dear to the hearts of the moderns, but it turns them to creative purpose. So people loved his work, did very well, but it is had this kind of modernist industrial feel that was very popular in mural design at this time period because of, you know, the influence of Diego Rivera. Really kind of like a hearty, heavy kind of work, I feel like, just like that wine that you all are tasting right now. So Lafarge actually went on to compete for a mural project during WPA, the Works Project Administration, and was selected to do a mural in New London, Connecticut. This is actually still on view in the post office there, Life on a Whaling Ship. And again, the image is a little grainy, so I apologize for that, but it is in the ceiling of the post office. So if you can imagine looking up, you can kind of see yourself on a whaling ship in terms of perspective, which is really interesting. So he's showing kind of all the stages of that without showing the whale itself, of capturing the whale and then harvesting the whale. So that went up in 1938. And the ship connection is really interesting for his own life. During World War II, he enlisted in the Coast Guard Reserves. And then was stationed on a trawler patrol off of Greenland during the war. And sadly, that ship he was commanding actually was lost at sea. So his body, all the sailors, the entire ship was never found. So he was presumed to have died. So kind of a tragic arc to Thomas Lafarge, but kind of all starting with that one drawing, which is just what I love about art. You know, you can start with this one thing and then it leads you down this trail with lots of twists and turns that ultimately, you know, comes back to connect to what you're talking about. So when I'm thinking about like looking for depictions of the Loire Valley and all these different kind of architecture, you know, we have the Renaissance architecture that we just looked at with the chateau, but of course, France has a very long history. We saw that with the Gothic cathedrals, and we think about Romanesque that came before. And so we're going to take another kind of detour, leaving Amboise. We're going to go up the river here to this town called Beaugency, right here, just above Bois, and visit kind of, this is very different architecture than the chateaus we were just looking at. So here's the Loire River and the bridge leading to Beaugency. This is a central tower called, nicknamed Caesar Tower, because it dates back to the Roman era in terms of the first iteration of it. And then we've got the church right next to it here, both from the 11th Abbey Church, dating from the 12th century. And here's a detail of that tower. And the reason I'm kind of landing on this is it relates to this work of art from our collection. And again, sorry for the poor quality. It's not on view right now, so I couldn't go to the galleries to take a picture. So it is a work of art by Jacques Vian, called Three Orders, the Castle, the Church, and the Land. So if you can kind of follow along with me. So we have this tower, kind of the Roman tower here, that was later built, a castle was built on top of it. So it's also known as the castle in the town. And if you can see the rectangle here, can everyone see kind of that impression of the tower? And then to the right of the tower, just as in the photograph, we have that Abbey Church here. And even at that same angle, you can see the outline of the church with its steeped roofs. I'm just gonna go over it with this cursor. So even though it is very abstracted here, we can still get that feeling of those two buildings kind of in the middle of the composition and really stabilizing the composition and rooting it in. But then we have that same expanse of landscape in the back. of the town and that Loire River. Do you see the river back here kind of curling around with the bridge? Yeah, it's really beautiful. And it's the other kind of nod with this three orders, the castle. So we have the castle, the church, and the landscape. Is also a nod to sort of that feudal system or that layers of caste, just like we had in the tomb, you know, of Philip the Bold and John the Fearless. So we could see the castle, the nobility, the church, the clergyman, and the land, the commoner, or the everyday people. So 1944, so that's like 1340, right? All the way to 1944, these same themes are kind of carried throughout this landscape and the telling, the storytelling of the human condition, right, in France, which is, I think, it's just a really lovely arc. Now, Jacques Villon, interesting dude. So this is him in the middle here with his brothers, and you might know his brothers, might ring a bell more so than him. This is Marcel Duchamp and Raymond Duchamp. So his born given name is actually Gaston Duchamp. Jacques Villon is sort of a nom de plume. He changed it to Villon after a French poet, and Jacques, he liked to be called Jack. So that's how he kind of landed on Jacques Villon. And again, remember I said like art can lead you down this path where everything connects all of a sudden. So Jacques Villon formed with a bunch of other artists a group called Section d'Or, or the Golden Section, kind of looking at that golden mean, that perfect ratio, right, in nature, but also architecture, after reading Da Vinci. So Da Vinci talks about the golden section, and while he was reading that, that's what he kind of inspired him to name this group. So it's all coming back, right, to Da Vinci. And Villon was really, again, really interesting guy. I mean, he ran in those circles with his brothers in Paris, but he really was interested in printmaking. He started out as a cartoonist early on, switched to printmaking, and then got into painting, and really stuck to himself or lived in the country most of the time, didn't really go in those Parisian circles as much. And he moved to Beaugency during the war and stayed there most of the time. He was older, and Beaugency is one of, didn't get a lot of damage during the war. So the work of art, the painting, the three orders, you know, this again, kind of connecting back to Thomas. So while Thomas Lafarge was, with the Coast Guard, you know, he was in France, but both affected by the war. So this was painted just a year after Thomas or other artists had passed away. And just another example, just to get you a feel of the variety of medium that he worked in and the kind of work he did. This is a watercolor study in the museum's collection. The museum has about 25 works by Villon. But he also did a lot of etching and lithograph and printmaking. That was kind of his preferred medium. But painting later in life, for sure, much more abstracted. This is a little bit representational, but definitely gets into more abstract. This is a great photograph from 1950 of Villon painting by Versailles from the Albert Max Gallery. And seeing the artist at work. And then just another Beaugency landscape. So this is a different perspective of the town from the bridge, but we still see that color palette, very saturated color. To me, it's very kind of end of summer, merging into fall for me as a color palette, personally. Any questions about Jacques or kind of these landscapes? They're very different views of the Loire Valley, but showing that range of architecture, but then also just kind of across time and how artists or different artists are perceiving that architecture and documenting it. Kind of gets back to what you were saying, Harry, you know, just thinking about like what you bring to the wine or the experience and what you taste is going to be very different from the next person. How an artist perceives that landscape or that building, it's, you know, his or her own take of that scene is going to be different depending on their perspective.
Agreed. I do see a question there, Liz, it might be for you. Restaurant hours, Ann Johnson.
Oh, Sorry, I did not see that. Restaurant hours, we are open 365 every day of the year for lunch from 11:30 to 3:30. We do snack light plates after 3:30, and we are open for dinner Wednesday night, Thursday night, and Friday night until 8. Well, we take our last reservation at 8. We have the same hours as the museum does, roughly.
Anyone have any other kind of questions, lingering impressions of the wine you just tasted, the second wine, or of the work of art we just looked through? Thanks, Margie, for your thanks. All right. Well, I want to thank Liz and Harry for joining us today and giving that great overview of the Gamay grape from both Beaujolais region and the Loire Valley. I learned a lot. Like, the Loire Valley goes a lot further south than I knew for fur wine.
The other thing I found, so Côte Rouennaise as an appellation is actually one of the original and oldest appellations in the Loire Valley, which I thought was pretty interesting to be so far away from the Loire Valley wines.
Yeah.
I see a question from Catherine. These wines are available. You can order them through the VMFA to go, which you can connect to on our website. But I'm also going to have them by the glass in a muse for the next week or two until we go out. So I'll have them probably starting Monday. If you come in for lunch or dinner, you can get it by the glass or come and pick up a bottle to take with you.
And if you're outside of Richmond too, you know, you can always contact your local small wine shop and you know, ask. Oh, okay, great. So someone's already reading ahead, which is awesome. I love it. So our next Taste of Art program. So just to give a plug for those, again, Fridays after 5, this is part of a whole series every Friday presented by Chase. So next tasting actually will be our first Taste of Art beer. So if you like beer along with your wine, or you know, separate, don't mix, or you know someone who's really into beer, please encourage them to register for October 24th. We're going to be welcoming Virginia Beer Company from Williamsburg, and I'll probably do a little spooky Halloween themed art pairing with that. And then our next Taste of Art for wine is going to be South African Wine and Art, and that's going to be on Friday, November 13th with educator Karen Getty, and we will announce kind of who the wine rep will be. And someone asked, could you order the South African wines ahead of the 13th? We live in Charlottesville. Liz, that's a question for you.
Yeah, we can't ship any wine. I should probably have it in about 2 weeks before the date of the tasting. So you can order them and swing by and pick them up. I know it's quite a hike from Charlottesville, but whatever we decide on, we'll have that on the website as soon as we come up with it. So you can look ahead and probably order it from one of your local wine stores. And as far as the wines from last week that someone is, or last taste that someone is asking about, I'll have to check in and see what I have left, because I know that we bought the last case from you, Harry, didn't we, of the wines from the last tasting?
Yes, one of them was all that we had.
I'll have to check and see what we have in inventory, but I might have some left. Feel free to email me or call me or call Amuse, and I can look into that for you and see if I can scrounge up some bottles for you.
Yeah, and Pat, I'm happy to help you connect with Liz to do that. And yes, so I have a little typo there. Should be Friday, October 23rd for the beer. Thanks, Mom Neff. Okay, so I will also say we're doing our best to get the whole recording of these programs up on YouTube. So if you missed the first one on September 11th, that is available on YouTube. So I encourage you to go check that out. And we hope to get this up within the next week or week and a half on our YouTube channel. So again, we really appreciate you all logging in, getting those wines, and enjoying the tasting with us. We love the comments, so keep those coming. Speaking of comments, everyone will get a survey. That's another opportunity for you to share your impressions from today's event and what you might be interested in learning about next go around. So I, again, just want to thank Liz and Harry, our panelists, for joining us today and sharing your expertise. And yes, thank you. You're welcome. You're welcome. And I hope everyone has a great weekend.
Great. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
It's always fun just talking about wine and seeing everybody. And it's always seeing you too, because I haven't seen you in person for a while now.
I know. Everyone take care.
Yes.
All right.
Bye.
Great weekend.